In order.
Roll call.
Bassing.
Here.
Bush.
Here.
Dolphin.
Here.
Hay.
Here.
Kinch. Stefan.
Here.
Stevenson.
Here.
All stand for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We'll start off with recognitions.
All right, math team. We are very excited to do some recognitions of some fantastic accomplishments from some of our student groups tonight. And starting with the math team that brings home some golds at the SWAL meet. Just a quick overview, the Mineral Point Middle School and High School math teams, another stellar SWAL conference meet on Thursday, May 9th in Fenimore. We have Mr. Chambers and Ms. Notham here as two of our representatives. Would you like to share a little bit more about, we've got a lot of the names up here, but why don't you just walk us through the math meet and share some of the highlights for us?
Well, I'll start with the middle school. The middle school is a little different than the high school where every school in the conference takes 10 kids, a mixture of 7th and 8th grade, and everybody takes the same test, and then they just kind of score them, and the top tier then would all get gold medals. And we ended up, out of the 10 students that went, we ended up with 8 gold medals. We had 6. We had 6 students in the top 9 at the competition, and Drew Hottenstein, who is not here, ended up finishing 2nd by 1 point. So, very nice job by these. And when we do practice, when we go through some things, and our motto is, you know, we're going and we're going to try to put everybody in the gold medal range. And you know, at first they might not all buy into that, but by the time we get to the end, I think they're a little more motivated to see what they can do. Sometimes we've got to twist the arms behind the back a little bit just to get the most out of them. But hey, whatever it takes. So. Excellent job by this group again this year.
Fantastic. And Ms. Nolan, you want to talk to us a little bit about the high school?
Yeah, so the high school is a little bit different. So at Algebra 1 Geometry, Algebra 2 Pre-Calc, and then this year they added a Calculus division. We take 5 students from each school, and each student takes 4 tests. They take 3 individually, and then they take the 4th one as a team. And so then when they calculate the scores, it's the top score in each division that gets a gold, and then they award the silver, and then up to 8 medal winners, then they fill in with the bronze. And so we are very proud of Abby this year taking the top score overall in the pre-calc division. We also did have, and you can see the names up there, but we had a few silvers and bronzes as well. And so very proud of all of them because, again, it's not just a cutoff score. They're competing against their peers and did a really nice job.
Congratulations. We're going to circle through here, just kind of go right around the board. They'd love to shake your hands. We've got a gift for each of you as you head out. So congratulations. Come on down this way. Congratulations. Nice job.
Good job.
Always another step.
How are you doing,
man? Good.
And then we do have some pens for Mr. Chambers and Ms. Nolson. There's a pen right there for you. Yep, you get the pens. Thanks. Thanks for coming, Dr.
Maybe,
All right. right, our second group that we are recognizing tonight is Odyssey of the Mind, who placed second at state. They are led by Ms. Wilson, and would you like to share a little bit about this year's competition and your team?
This year, we placed second, and we have a definite trend going with second. We were trying to break that by going for first in 12 times for worlds. But at any rate, this year's team, they are very good at spontaneous problem solving, which is good because we have spontaneous problems. They each, 8 minutes before going in to the long-term problem, we were missing two props. And so we got some extra spontaneous problems thrown at us, so we got to figure it out. So, an example of a spontaneous problem would be, what is it?
I create something to fix a clothes dryer with this.
People try to come up with names.
Are we? Oh, I thought she was asking.
Make it into something.
Okay.
Just sure. Be quick. You have 10 seconds, tops.
1, 2, 3.
No pressure.
Four,
he's got enough
five,
of that.
6, 7.
Okay,
eight,
tell your story.
9.
An edible pencil.
Excellent.
Pencil.
Yep.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Make it.
6.
Use your pass.
Time's up.
A glass is older.
Okay.
That's not better.
Good enough. Good.
Get electric here.
What a sweet child. Okay. Okay, Beth.
A fish.
Aww.
Excellent.
That's a claw.
Look. Pass.
Until one of the team members finishes. Remember the rules.
Gosh,
beautiful.
Poor vision.
A snail with poor vision. Excellent.
An unusable spring.
Excellent. So, it's all about function. There is more than one right answer, which could be really helpful as you look at the budget. So yes, our spontaneous problem solving pulls us off every time. We scored second on that. Our long-term problem, we didn't do so well on because it's kind of, we had a few issues. I have yet another plan in next year.
No.
But thank you so much for your support, and thank you for your time. And yeah. Next year, they'll have a bunch of people going through high school, so that's a whole new pool to draw from. We are optimistic.
Congratulations.
Kappa Gamma, the literacy competition, and Miss Bennett. I'm sorry.
Just scroll down a little bit. So we have names. Yeah.
Thank you.
There you go.
Awesome. I'm so glad you could be here, Miss Bennett. I know you were rushing to make it, so welcome. Want to share a little bit about this year's team?
I'm gonna let Reagan do the talking, and then I'll just help out.
Delta Kappa Gamma, you have to write and illustrate your own book, and you have to edit it and send it in, and there are. You need to follow the instructions, like, for I think, third to fifth grade, you can't have more than 600 words, which was a big problem for me because I like to write long stories. And then you send it in, and a few weeks later, you can get a letter, and they'll say, congrats, you got this place, and you'll be going here for a banquet. And this year, me and Gavin Holtrocker both got first place. And I think he got first place in artwork. And I got first place in literature and second place in artwork, I think. And
what exciting news did you find out later?
Yes, I was very excited.
What exciting news did you find out later?
And then afterwards, it got sent to state, and I got third place in state.
Awesome.
Is this a project you did in one night?
No. It took about a month.
Yeah, it's an extensive project. It involves all the different aspects of writing, using dialogue, editing. You have to match your illustrations to your writing. And it's a very creative project. You get every type of story, you get every type of illustration. And this year we had 19 participants. That's a lot, I thought. And Gavin Holtrocker had first in illustrations and second in literary. You had first in literary and illustrations at the local, and they both will be attending a really nice banquet down in Platteville. And they'll get to see the other local winners. Local means Lafayette, Grant, and Iowa County. But then Reagan went on to state, so she was competing against a lot of other people, and she got third at state, which is fantastic. And then we had Jaden Swinehart that had second place in the illustrations and third place in literary. Ella Wilson had second place in illustrations, second place literary. Elizabeth Dunn, second place in literary. Jaden Schultz, Mr. Schultz's daughter, he's taught her a lot, third place in illustration. And Cody, third place on literary, and then Rita Wilson, second place in illustration. So we had 8 of the 19 that entered that actually received a placing on it. But we really stressed with the students, it's not about placing, it's about taking on a big project, putting effort in it, perseverance. We had to go through a little perseverance, we had a little bump in the road, and we figured it out, didn't we? We worked as a team, and it all turned out great. And then I talked with Mr. Renwick, and he's going to allow me to have an author lunch where all the participants will bring in their books and they'll all share with each other so that they all can feel good that they were part of this and that they took on a project that involved a lot of work along with all the regular school work. So very proud of every student that participated in grades 3 through 5.
Great job.
Okay, and we have our FFA awards. Mr. Robinson's here. Share some exciting news with us.
Sure. Well, we're here to honor Tommy tonight. She's our state qualifier in the prepared speaking contest for the FFA. The FFA is always pretty ruthless in things and how they do stuff, and it's you're either first or you're done. And so in order to move on to the next level, Tommy won at the sectionals, so that automatically makes her one of the top 10 in the state, because we have 10 sections across the state, so she's one of the top 10 already. The first go-round at state is a qualifying round, so if she makes that, then she becomes one of the top 4 in the state as well. And then we'll be recognized in front of 3,000 people at the state convention. But so she does a great job. Her speech is on GMOs, Way to Go, is the title of it, and it's on genetically modified organisms. So if anybody ever has any free time, about 6 to 8 minutes worth of it, she'll perform the speech for you. But again, she's done a great job representing us, and we wish her luck at state. So.
Way to go, Tom.
Thank you.
the minutes. Do we have a motion to approve?
I'll second.
Second by Julie. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Communications, board communications received? Citizen communications. We have one name. Kim.
And we do have transportation on the agenda later, so would you like to address now or later?
Later is just fine. I just wanted to make sure that you were aware I was here. I don't know how many are familiar with who I am, so just wanted to introduce myself and let you know I am here to address it when it comes to that topic.
You gotta stick around.
Thank you.
Thank you, Kim.
Anybody else? All right, we'll move on. Business services. Credit card statement of activity and bills payable. Do we have a motion for them two together?
I'll make a motion.
Motion by Jeff. A second?
I'll second.
Questions on the credit card or the bills? All right, hearing none, the roll call. Andy?
Bastin.
Abstain.
Bush.
Yes.
Dolphin.
Yes.
Hay.
Yes.
Stevenson.
Yes.
Steffes.
Yes.
Motion approved. Budget amendments. Do you want to go through them a little bit?
Yeah, these the budget amendments that are in your board packet are pretty straightforward. They cover deficits in accounts and corrects the flow through grants. All of the money, again, is budgeted. It's in our budget. It just needs to be reallocated, redistributed in order to not show negative balances, and that's part of our DPI reporting. So it's pretty standard. Districts across the state are amending their budgets this time of year to show that monies are appropriately expensed to the accounts that are running in the negative.
I'll move to approve.
Motion by Lisa. Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Do we have a second? Mm-hmm. Any other discussion? A roll call.
Hay?
Yes.
Stevenson?
Yes.
Bastin?
Yes.
Bush?
Yes.
Dolphin?
Yes.
Steffes?
Yes. Motion approved. Employee services.
The first that is before the board is approval of a preliminary notice of non-renewal. This is due to budget and staffing for the 17-18 year. Specifically, Kelly Ritchie is in a 1.0 FTE interpreter position. And at the end of this year, we would make a recommendation to non-renew. But I would share with the board that we anticipate a student moving from another district into the Mineral Point district that will need interpreting services. And at that point, we would promptly offer Ms. Ritchie a contract right back again. So this is in a way to just ensure that if the student doesn't move into the district, that we don't have two interpreters for the one student we currently have. And it gives us some flexibility in our staffing. But if we have a position available, we most assuredly would want to offer it to Ms. Ritchie.
Do we have a motion?
When do you anticipate hearing from the student?
We cannot get confirmation that the student is going to enroll until they, first of all, de-enroll or unenroll from the current school district they're residing in, and that most likely won't happen until year's end. And at the time that they drop the student from their enrollment, then we can officially add them to our enrollment. So most likely June.
I'm
going
to ask if Richie moves or apply to get something else. We have to find somebody else.
We would post the position and attempt to hire another interpreter, correct?
Because she's kind of a tough spot, isn't she?
Yes, for sure. And Ms. Ritchie's here tonight if you wanted to ask her how tough of a spot this puts her in. We certainly have communicated about the district's intention, and I'd be in good faith with the board's approval to give her a letter of intent to rehire her back should we have a student available that's in need of services.
So we have a motion and a second.
The motion should, can I add to it to include the letter of intent?
Absolutely.
Any other discussion? Kelly, anything?
Well, I just want to make a comment that I'm, of course, really dedicated to the district and have worked here for 7 years, so I really hate to have to leave. I feel like I'm part of the family now, even though my family doesn't live here. I'm obviously really dedicated, so I appreciate you and your intent to have that letter. So, sorry, I'm making motions.
Roll call, Angie.
Hay.
Yes.
Stevenson.
Yes.
Basting.
Yes.
Bush.
Yes.
Dolphin.
Yes.
Steffes.
Yes.
The second is an item for approval of a staff appointment. It's actually a reassignment. Pam Anderson, kindergarten teacher, wishes to retire from teaching, but does not want to yet leave the educational field. And so we would like to reassign her to a 1.0 FTE instructional assistant position. Pam would support specifically literacy efforts in K-3, as well as support our WIN time, which is our intervention time. Her salary would be based on step 10 of the 16-17 support staff salary schedule.
Let's get a motion in a second and we'll discuss it. Do we have a motion to approve Luke's recommendation? Motion by Julie, do we have a second?
I'll second.
Second by Larry. Discussion?
Will there be anybody filling her position?
Yes, we would post the position that we would post would actually be the kindergarten position, as we have a small group of kindergarten right now moving into first grade. So we would attempt to cover that with our existing staff, but we would need a additional position in the kindergarten group that has currently, I believe it's 56 kids in the class right now. So two classes of 25, maybe it's 54 kids. I think it was a 25 and a 24 in both classes, a little bit too much for kindergarten learners. So we would post a position and hire a vacancy for kindergarten.
So I think there we have, we'll have three.
Three teachers in kindergarten and two teachers with a 4/10 of a reallocation of Kimberly Diefenbach in first grade.
First grade. All right.
So 2.5 teachers, if you would, in first grade.
Do we need this as instructional assistant?
I believe it's in the best interest for the district to hire this position, yes, to support our literacy effort. It will definitely support our strategic goal of 100% literacy by third grade. And Ms. Anderson has a skill set that we can certainly use to help support that effort.
So will she be working directly with, maybe just like us, Kim and Rachel, or Mrs. Schrader?
In part of the day. The nice part about it is Ms. Anderson's been in both kindergarten and first grade in the past 2 years, and has also taught second grade in the past. So we feel very comfortable that she can support the WIN time, which is that shorter period of time that's staggered throughout the day, and be an extra group that can work with small groups of kids. In addition to directly supporting the kindergarten and first grade literacy efforts in the classroom as an additional body to try to support. Yeah.
She was one of those offered that buyout too, wasn't she?
Correct.
Retirement.
Correct.
She didn't go for that.
She would prefer to come back as an instructional assistant, but if that weren't to be offered, then she would ask for that consideration.
How long is she for retirement?
She's actually wishes to retire from teaching now, so she's eligible to retire. She would just like to come back in a different capacity.
Will the number of instructional assistants change for next year, Luke, or will we be adding a position in the elementary then?
This would increase our instructional assistants by one.
By one. All right. There's no other plan changes?
Not at this time.
Okay.
We'll continue to monitor our student population. There may be other adjustments that could recapture this position in the future, but right now it would be an increase of one FTE for instructional assistants.
That's her included. I mean,
that is her included, right.
So what's the total instructional? What's the total?
The total.
Of instructional assistants?
Total FTE?
Yeah.
I don't know, because some of that is allocated to special ed and some are regular ed.
Okay.
I would have to check on that before I respond.
you know by chance?
I'll have to tap my head, I can't tell you, sorry.
Throughout the whole district, will we be zeroed out on employees then with the Kelly Ritchie situation?
At this time, we would, yes.
Okay.
If Kelly Ritchie came back on, it would be, again, an additional worry about the...
What would the overall cost difference be, Lou, between a certified professional and instructional assistant?
If we're going to get into salary and compensation and differences, maybe we should move that into closed session. We can talk more specifically about...
Do you have an approximate for the board before we vote?
You know, roughly, we have teaching salaries, and again, it's based on longevity, but benefits are a wash whether you're certified or not, so that is no difference in compensation. But typically, an instructional assistant would make between $18,000 and $24,000, and a certified staff member would start at $35,000 as a starting salary and go up to about $45,000.
Can we discuss this in closed session? Is there something?
We can move this into closed session if you like.
Okay.
Yeah. Just take a motion from the board to officially do that.
I'd like to date my motion to move it into closed session.
There's no change in motion to move it into closed session.
Sure.
Who seconded that?
Glad he did.
Larry. Everybody in favor of moving this into closed session at the end of the meeting, say aye.
Sorry.
Opposed? Okay, we will. Items for information and discussion.
We have Mr. Ruskey here. If you want to pull one of our chairs over, join us at the table.
There's another chair. I can.
Oh, I'm good. Join me right here. I'm Joe Ruskey. I've met many of you, and some of you I may not have. I'm the technology business owner for Dependable Solutions, who supports Mineral Point as well as 26 other districts throughout Wisconsin, Iowa, Minnesota. I know that I'll kind of give you a brief overview of what we've done in the past year, and then I will go a little bit into the discussion on full-time in-house versus outsource. I just looked at tickets. I pulled a report before I came in here. Last year at this time, we had approximately, last year for the entire year, there was approximately 1,660 help desk tickets. That can range anywhere from big network wireless issues all the way down to, hey, my printer jammed. This year to date, and we still have 3 months left of the year, we're already at 2,022 tickets. It's not because there is more problems, but it's because you're using more technology is really what it is. More and more, Mineral Point really is a leader in technology. Like I said, we work with 25 other districts, and Mr. Francois keeps us on our toes. He keeps pushing us and pushing us, and so that's a good thing for your district. So the more technology you use, the more technology support it requires. With that said, so I know you're considering, you know, what makes more sense from a board, bring somebody in full-time on staff. There's benefits to that. I'm not going to lie. There's benefits to having somebody here full-time so that if somebody's teaching and there's an issue, it's easier to get that person. Maybe they'll respond even during the actual class. There's also cost issues that you have to consider too, and downsides to it. I know right now we have districts that have tried that. Some have gone to what we call a hybrid solution, to where maybe they bring in, they keep us in there to handle the higher end stuff, and they bring in somebody lower. Lancaster was doing that for a while, and now they've reversed that back to where we're running the entire district. The big problem right now is technology. There's a huge demand for technology people. Right now, you know, I'm constantly hiring, and my staff, just to keep my internal staff, in the past 12 months, I've increased salaries 20%. I've increased benefits, and I've increased vacation. Everybody, January 1, got another 5 days of vacation. So an average junior person that I would bring on last year for $35,000, that's somebody no experience just walking out of the tech school. This year it cost me $45,000. By the year 2020, there's going to be a shortage. They're expecting 1 million jobs and not enough people, 1 million jobs that can't be filled in the IT industry. So the, one of the benefits of having an IT consulting firm is that's my responsibility to find it. You don't have to. You're not constantly have to having to up salaries. I upped salaries 3 times last year just to continue to stay competitive. So we're able to be a little more flexible, and we didn't raise your rates at all, even during that. So we're able to stay be a little more flexible. One of the other things to consider is we do the training, we do the vacation, we do that. If somebody's sick, you guys, doesn't affect the school district, we handle that. But like I said, some schools like to have that person in-house for that immediate response. I think 90% of the time you'll find that the response doesn't require an immediate, and so we're able to handle it a lot. So up to this point, we've continued to increase the technology in the district. You know, you hear that one-to-one. You're one-to-one. You've been one-to-one for a long time, even if you don't have everybody take one home. It's one device per student. You're probably 1.5 to 1, if not more, if we really ran the numbers. We are recommending this year, you're starting to outgrow some of your technology. One of the things that you've outgrown is your wireless technology. What we're hoping, what we're recommending is to take advantage of some of the E-rate money that's out there, the federal money, and get part of that project paid for. Redo the entire high school and middle school. Take those extra ones that we free up from the high school and middle school and bump them over to the elementary school and fill in all the spots. I think we're on the 4th year of the wireless here, and while it doesn't sound old in technology, we're getting pretty old. And so I think we can get a couple more years out of it if we move it over to the elementary where they don't have as high demands as you do here at the high school, middle school. Other than that, we're continuing to work with Mr. Francois and the administration team and look at devices, you know, what's the best, Chromebooks, Apple devices, whatever. And we're just trying to take direction and get back if we can. So with that, I don't want to talk too much, so I'll answer any questions that you may have. I'm sorry I don't speak as well as a young author did. She was phenomenal. You should be proud to have her in your district.
So you are the owner of this company. When did you start it?
We started in 2003.
With how many employees, and how many employees do you have now?
Okay. We started with one employee, me. Well, two, my wife was doing all the books. She was an unpaid employee. we now have 15 employees. We're in negotiation right now with hiring 2 more. And we're slated to be at 25 employees within the next 15 months.
Every problem that Mentor Point has had, were your company able to fix it for us?
Yes.
Good. 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 Have we ever had to wait for you?
I don't know what wait is. I mean, a couple hours, yeah.
Sure.
But, yeah.
Not 2 weeks or anything like that?
No. We have people here all the time, and we take care of Mineral Point and other districts, so Darlington. I don't like to mention that word in this room. I know there's a rivalry there. So we're in the area as well. You know, we work with Lancaster and stuff, so we're close. Yeah.
Did the Chromebooks use up some of the wireless, the capacity on the wireless that you're talking about?
Yeah, so yes. Basically, when we put the wireless system, when the wireless system was designed, which Dependable didn't do, but it was designed 4 years ago and put into place, it was designed and put into place correctly. It was designed for the equipment that you currently had. And so, you know, if you walk down the halls, you'll see it in the hallways and stuff. The problem with that is now as you're moving to a one-to-one environment where more kids have these smaller devices, these devices, quite honestly, have very poor wireless cards built into them. And so what's happening is they're trying to reach out into the halls, and you're having multiple classrooms. So you might have 40 to 60 devices hitting a single access point in the hall, where when it was designed, you might have only had 10. And so what's happening is it's consuming the access point. It's just not able to handle it.
How do student cell phone usage, how is that affecting
the wireless? The cell phone usage when they're trying to get around the filter, they're not touching your wireless. They're running off their data. But when they don't want to touch their data plans and they just want to search the internet or they can hop onto the guest network, which is then consuming part of your internet, part of your bandwidth on your wireless as well. The new design that we're recommending is almost, it's one access point for every other classroom. So we're almost doubling the amount of access points that we have in there. We're pulling them out of the hallways because they're just not, it's just not sufficient. Plus you have some thick walls here. And so the signals just aren't going through the walls the way they should. So we think that if we put approximately one access point for every two classrooms, they would be designed to not only handle those cell phones and the Chromebooks and all that, they would also handle the density, which is what we're having a problem with right now.
And this funding, you talked about the E-funding. Where's that coming?
So E-rate funding is federal funding that basically every time you pay your cell phone bill, you pay all those high taxes. Mm-hmm. Well, the government takes that and they're giving back some of that funding to schools and libraries so that they can do wireless projects and things like that. I think right now you might have 44,000 pre-discount. So you're probably at about 22,000 available that we might be able to get for this project. I don't know how
so
much is
free to upgrade?
Correct. It would probably be about 50 cents on the dollar. Maybe a little less. We've already applied for the funding, so it would fall into the 17-18 school year. And we're currently under a test scenario where we have that system in place on a free 60-day trial just to test it before we buy it.
I have a question about your question about weight. Do you have sort of different like service level agreements depending on what the issue of the ticket is, where you have a certain response time?
So, I mean, obviously, we haven't signed a newer SLA recently, but we did sign one with the district. And basically, if it's a network down, server down, we're here within an hour and a half, 90 minutes. So we do have SLAs. The nice thing, too, is the more that we move into the technology stuff, we're able to do a lot of stuff remotely, too. Mm-hmm. So sometimes we're fixing problems before we even leave our office. And then it's the stuff where you actually have to touch the equipment, where we wait till we come on site. And we're on site, at Mineral Point, we're on site at least 3 days a week. And it's driven by tickets. We try not to be on site if we don't have to, because then it saves the district money. But when there's enough tickets, we make sure we're on site.
SLA, is
it
scope of...
I'm sorry, service level agreement. Though I'm sure you have some acronyms with the school, I wouldn't know what they were either, so.
So it's our teachers, and I just... To Larry's question about weight, I mean, are teachers aware of those SLAs and things like that? So, like, if you've got a jam printer, probably someone's not coming in an hour, right? Or you're going to need to probably troubleshoot on your own versus the server down thing. So,
correct.
Yeah. Okay.
And we also have, so we put in a new ticketing system, I think, 18 months ago. And one of the things that my staff has instructed for a client your size is they have to respond to all tickets within 2 hours if they're not emergencies. Okay. And that doesn't mean they have to fix them, but they better respond at least and tell a staff member, hey, we'll be on site tomorrow, or, you know, and we'll take a look at it then. Do you need something sooner? And 99% of the time, staff respond with that, depending on what it is. And I use a terrible example, printer jam. They can fix most of the time on their own. But, yeah, so we do communicate with them. We don't just wait until we show up on site.
Yeah, there's schools. Oh, compared to last year, and even... For that, do you see an increased budget projection?
Yeah, we're seeing budgets go up a little bit. We're trying to hold costs down for schools because we know the only way you can raise revenue is referendums. And so we're trying to hold costs down. I don't think we anticipated that much of an increase from Mineral Point. I don't know if we did any.
Maybe. I didn't see any. I think the service agreement budget went up by $10,000 just because the volume is more than it has been. But that number had stayed static for 4 straight years. So we budgeted $75,000 for service by Dependable Solutions. The proposed budget will most likely have an $85,000 budget line item there, which would be, I don't know what the going rate out of tech is with salary and benefits, but I'm going to guess it's right in there and we get the full fleet of deployment that comes in. So I think of in the summer, what it would take to image one computer at a time down the row, they bring in a group of 5 to 6 and they knock a computer lab out in a couple hours. So that's where they've got the critical mass when they need it. And then when the whole network is down, I see Joe. Otherwise, to be honest, I don't see Joe much because I don't need that level of expertise. We have other people that are here that are much more frequent day to day with the lower level things, but they've got the resources deploying when they need them.
How often is somebody from your company here in our school?
At least 2 days and sometimes 3 days a week. And I mean, there's times where if there's, you know, testing, it really ebbs and flows. Like state testing, we'll see us a lot more, obviously, because testing is so important. Probably the end of April, beginning of May, when teachers start to spin down a little bit and they're finishing up the year, it'll drop probably 2 days a week just because teachers don't need us here. So, and you know, September 1, we'll probably be on site every day that week for the first week of September and maybe even the second week. So it's really driven by needs.
Has there been any conversation ever about having somebody situated here on a regular basis?
Yeah, there is, and I'll tell you honestly, it's not worth you paying us to do it. We've had this with a couple schools. If you paid us to do it, we would be sitting here not doing, we'd be twiddling our fingers a lot of the times.
But couldn't they do other work for other schools while they're here?
They could, but then I'm paying them to travel and all that. So from a cost-benefit analysis, from my perspective, it doesn't make sense either.
Where's your office?
We have an office in Prairie, we have one in Prairie Sheen, one in La Crosse, and one in Boscobel.
Do you service other schools nearby here?
Yep, Lancaster, Darlington, and Narrow Point in this area. And then we also have, you know, Cassville and Prairie Sheen and River Ridge as we start moving out that way. And then in La Crosse, we have Onalaska, and then we're in Minnesota, we have Houston.
Because if you had somebody stationed here and they were, you know, dealing with the other schools that are nearby, it could cut down on other people's travel costs too.
Yep. Yeah, and we're actually looking at a possible office in Lancaster, mm-hmm. Because we are getting drawn more this way. I just don't want to make a promise yet until that works out. But we are looking at an office in Lancaster and expanding services to school too, outside of the technical area as well, with curriculum stuff and hiring certified teachers to be on our staff to help us with some of that stuff.
We have some storefronts available on
our call is better than my
staff. Along those lines, and you may not have the curriculum information needed, but with the explosion of jobs available and the high starting rate out of a tech school, do we have the hardware here to help introduce students to the IT field? You know, maybe Luke can comment on that.
I'm sure we have some older stuff. I think it would be great. Are you still CISA 3?
Yes.
I know Southwest Tech is trying to start bringing their, because we were working with them on Prairie, trying to bring some of their networking course so that you can knock some of it out in high school. I don't know. What I think needs to be done is it needs to happen at all levels, and Dependable Solutions, we would help in any way we could, because let me tell you, it is so hard to hire people in this area. Because even when they go to Southwest Tech or somewhere else, they immediately want to hit the cities. They don't realize, you know, 2-year degree, I mean, you're coming out 20 years old and I'm paying you 35 grand and you're getting 3 weeks vacation, and I mean, you're making a good living. You know, and I've got people that are honestly 5 years in the industry making over 55 grand. So I mean, I would be more than willing to help Narrow Point and any other school district tell our kids, quit moving away and let's get some good jobs going in this area, because boy, do we need it. And I think if we partnered with Southwest Tech, they might have that curriculum you're looking for. And maybe some of this consortium stuff does too that you're working with as well.
And we now have available to us an AP programming course that's offered through Pecatonica through Telepresence. And we still do our coding day every year to try to create interest, but it's not embedded in the curriculum. We have made some movements into graphic arts as a course that we now offer, which is newer to Mineral Point, but a truly embedded program that puts you on a track. You're probably right, we're partnering with Southwest Tech or something like that.
And, yeah, and I would, Dependable would love to help with that, whether it's some sort of financial contribution or whatever. We're that serious about it that it's that hard to find employees. So we would be willing to work with the district and all the districts in the area if we could do that.
Thank you, Joe. Any other questions? Great. Thank you very much. I'm always available for questions. Thank you. Safety committee report.
Brief report of our safety committee met again last month, and we have a meeting upcoming in April. One of the things the district did recently, or the committee did recently, is start to prioritize some of our safety committee work into areas and put in some subpoints. And you'll see some of the questions that were asked and answered by our committee. What's working in our district? What's effective? Do students feel safe? And what resources are available? How do we ensure consistency across buildings? What are our current vulnerabilities? The scope of the committee's work. is to really review and develop, and they focused in on suicide prevention because that's one of the largest areas of risk, and then review and improve policies to reduce transportation accidents. Those were two areas that they definitely wanted to spend some time developing a recommendation for the board around. What should not be in the scope, just routine drills and so forth, or infectious disease policies are things that we're going to steer clear of. And then what do we mean by school safety, because we had some other differing interpretations about what we were even tasked to do. And so we're looking at everything from weather to security, natural disasters, bullying, abuse, traffic areas, and so forth are some of the focus areas that we're studying. In conjunction with the work that was being done in committee to kind of drive down some of our key priorities is we also worked with EMC, which is our insurance carrier. They provided a security assessment. They came in last week and spent a half a day in both buildings. They looked at our written materials, and they also walked through and looked at just the security measures at each location. And we'll put together a report that will share their findings that will guide our committee's work when we get together in April. So we wanted to keep you updated with reports as we go forward. We anticipate wrapping some of our work in June at the latest and bringing back some recommendations from the committee to the board based on some of the discussions we've been having locally. Any questions?
Do we have any coming in the loop without vaccinations?
No, I don't believe so. We have pretty good records on vaccinations. Our school nurse is pretty diligent to make sure that students have all the required immunization records on file.
Do we have required, can we make them take them?
I don't know if we can. That's a question I can ask for Julie, if a parent can opt out of. I mean, I assume that they...
A vaccination?
Yeah.
Yeah, I believe there's a waiver they can have signed. Yeah.
Transportation policy. Want to give an overview, Luke?
Sure. Yep. And Kim Ellingson is here, so welcome, Kim. I appreciate you joining us for the meeting. It started, I received a call from our transportation coordinator, Todd Schmitz, in contact with Kim. Kim is in the process of transitioning to a new residence, and it was located in an area that is within 1.5 miles of the school that the student attends. And our current policy doesn't pick up or drop off within 1.5 miles of the school unless it's in a specially defined area that's designated by the county sheriff as a hazardous area. This area is not one of those locations. And so as Todd and I just drove past the residence and down around the streets, it isn't the best location to do a pickup and drop off because of some of the traffic areas at the top of kind of the gas station, the Blippi area. And as you go down the street, you're kind of on a hill, which makes it a little bit problematic. There's no sidewalks. It's not a great conducive area to pick up and drop off to begin with. But Todd was open to trying to find some solution and suggested Shake Rake Alley as a place to drop off, and the student could walk up the hill, but it requires crossing Commerce Street. And so that wasn't really preferred either from a parent perspective, because that is still a busy intersection and corner and so forth. Spoke with Todd again today, and his position remains the same in that it really starts to go down a slippery slope. There are a lot of students that within 1.5 miles that would want the courtesy to be picked up or dropped off. He does acknowledge that on the bus routes, this particular location has buses that travel right by the house on the way back to the bus barn. But again, if you start dropping kids off on the way back through and making special considerations, it just kind of goes into an area that Todd wasn't comfortable in entering. So Kim is here and will share some parent perspectives and questions and thoughts around what might be possible. And ultimately, this is guided by board policy, so if you wanted to lift the 1.5 mile outside of a hazardous area, we would go through a policy revision process. So it's on the discussion item for tonight. It's not up for action. And Kim and I have been in communication about it, and so I'm coming back up to you to fill in anything I left off, and we can go from there.
I honestly wasn't looking to expand the 1.5 miles. I was at, when I had asked Todd, I live at 270, we just moved into 217 West Commerce. And unfortunately, there's no direct route to our location that has sidewalks the entire way. So I contacted Todd originally. Well, my original communication went to Elaine Schwartz, and she told me to get in touch with Todd. So I did, and talked to him a little bit, asking if there was any current route that he was going on that would happen to have a place where he could let off Brock, my son, who's a sixth grader. And I asked if it was possible at the top of West Commerce and Ridge, or if there was a bus that maybe goes further down on 23 where Chestnut and Commerce meet. There's a triangle where there's a park there, and I just wondered if there was a route already. And he indicated that there was no place that he felt comfortable with stopping due to traffic. And I guess my original thought is, well, if it's not conducive to stop a bus, how is it conducive to let a child cross the street? The next option was to drop him off at the bottom of Shake Rag and Spruce, which I don't have a problem with him walking. History, we've been here 2 years. Came to the school district in 2015, and he walked every day to and from the elementary school. We lived at that time on High Street above the hardware store. And we decided to move and purchase a house. And so prior to that, he would take the shuttle bus that currently runs from the middle school, high school to the elementary school, and he would get dropped off and then walk home. So don't have a problem at all with him walking. I guess my concern is that the Shake Rag and Spruce required him to cross over 23. And in my research of it, it has, by the Wisconsin Department of Transportation, you're seeing 3,700 vehicles per day that is your traffic count for there at Highway 23. And that's 200 more per day than what's at your, where you have the crosswalk or the cone set out to cross to Water Tower Park. And so my thought is my child's going to have to cross the street at a rather busy location. There's no crosswalk, there's no sort of traffic control whatsoever. And I really wasn't looking at trying to ask for any sort of special route until I saw, well, or any special provision, until I saw the bus go in front of my house. And it was kind of disheartening as a mom to say, well, that you couldn't stop, just add one stop at the top. And today I followed a bus that did exactly what I had asked him to do. It was the 710 bus goes right on Ridge out to 23 and down 23, and then it goes out on 39, 23, as if it's going to the farm or a more rural location. And there's like six or seven kids on the bus, so it's not full. And he says that they won't stop. They won't add any additional stops because they didn't want to create havoc with the traffic on Ridge. I'm just frustrated, I guess, as a parent, that you don't want to stop the bus, but it's okay for my kid to cross the street there and for him to get home. And again, there's, you know, West Commerce, I know, doesn't have sidewalks, and I'm okay with, you know, I believe he can get places safely. I don't have any doubts with him, but I guess my biggest concern is come winter time, when he's having to walk about the one, you know, it's about 1.3 miles, I think, to our house, and I'm just concerned about him safely getting there with the traffic and such of where they've been asked to stop on Shake Rag. So again, I'm not trying to cause big havoc. I'm just here. I was hoping that maybe somebody would consider taking the normal route that they take and just add one additional stop on a normal route that the bus happens to go.
So if you go down Commerce from the gas station from Ridge, are you on the right or the left?
I'm on West Commerce, which is just one block off of Commerce. So, like, our street runs
Kelly.
Parallel.
So this is Commerce Street that goes up to Pit Stop.
Yeah.
And this is West Commerce. So it cuts across.
Can you say by so-and-so?
So there's a...
West Commerce.
Okay. Yeah, correct, yes. And okay. There's an apartment building.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Sure. Okay.
Yeah.
So Commerce isn't the issue. It's Ridge Street.
It doesn't have to be there.
I was willing to do whatever.
It could be at that park, the Triangle Park, that Whitford Park, whatever it's called. The bus is going by there anyway, right?
Correct.
And it has to stop at the stop sign. And you're only concerned with the way home from school, right?
Correct.
Not the way to school. And if he was on the bus, I mean, he'd go out into the country, and then he'd have to come, he'd be like the last stop as the bus is going back to the barn. I feel like there's got to be a common sense solution to this, and I don't...
Can I just ask, So the suggestion was Shake Rag, so that he would walk down a Shake Rag alley and then get on a bus? Is that what I was...
It's on the way home, you get off at Shake Rag and Spruce and walk up Spruce.
Got it, yep. I couldn't figure out where that made sense, but yes, got it. Okay.
And I myself did it, just to kind of see what it would be like. And when you get to Spruce and Commerce, you're sitting, like, in a car or even as an adult standing there. Mm-hmm. There's just that, you're right at that part of the hill where you can't really see down it. I mean, you can see pretty good to your right, but you just can't quite see down to the left.
Right, it's a blind bridge. Mm-hmm. Going, the traffic going up Commerce Street there, I mean, they're going pretty fast. And it's, I mean, kids would have to run across. That would be a dangerous thing. But if the bus is going then down 23 and then goes where that green triangle is, and is that what it does?
Yep.
And then it turns right onto West Commerce. I don't know why it couldn't stop there.
It does turn right onto West Commerce.
I think it actually comes up Commerce and turns left. Like, it's at the bus goes by our house at the end of the route and at the very beginning of the route. I was willing to wait for him to ride the bus, and he said he was fine with it as well, to ride the bus the entire route, and then when it comes back up Commerce Street and turns left onto West Commerce, I even said if they stopped right there, they don't have to drop them off in front of the house, I'm not asking for that, just to drop them off right there at the stop sign where that park is, and then he can walk the rest of the way up West Commerce.
It seems like other students might benefit if there was a stop there, too.
Would it be better to stop at the stop sign at the end of West Commerce, where you're actually at a stop sign?
There's actually one there at West Commerce and Chestnut. They have to stop there.
Right there.
Right here? Yep, right there.
Yeah.
Correct.
Yep.
Because I think it's bus 702 and 704 come by our house at 4:15 and at 4:30. And again, I'm not asking for front door service. I was just looking for a place that they could stop along their route back to the bus barn.
Because at the end of West Commerce,
my only concern there is crossing West. I mean, the people that they used to ride slow on that street because people fly down it, and crossing there seems to be
crossing Chestnut
to West Fly
down that.
Yeah,
that's
down
that
down
straight
there.
Downhill. They if you take a right,
the one they just redid.
Yeah.
Or you're coming up a hill and people.
But there's a nice sidewalk for kids that are walking.
Right, but there's no sidewalk across the street.
Not on West Commerce, but on Chestnut.
Yeah, West Commerce.
Do we have any other pickup or drop-off points inside the 1.5 miles other than the elementary?
Only as defined, and it's guided by a state statute that defines it as a hazardous area, and it has to be recognized by the county. We have two designated areas that I believe are considered hazardous inside the 1.5 mile radius. And so part of this is if the board wants to explore it further, I would bring you up to speed with the state statute around transportation and identifying hazardous areas inside of the radius that we transport to, and then certainly our board policy. But more so, school funding has a transportation component to it as a categorical aid, and that's why there's some statute around what is or isn't permissible with drop-offs and pickups. And the board has some flexibility within that. I did invite Todd to join us tonight, but he's preparing for an inspection tomorrow, and so he is tied up this evening. But as we go forward with the board and selecting operations committees and next meeting, it might be prudent for us to have a subcommittee that studies this along with Todd and Kim and have a further conversation around some of the challenges to see if there might be a solution.
Is there a drop-off at the library? It seems like I see kids.
No.
Get off. No?
Only on Wednesday, sometimes I'll take them down for early release, but there's no drop-off.
Just on Wednesday?
That's not every Wednesday.
You used to be a drop-off by the Royal, I wonder.
By where?
By the Royal drop net.
We used to AJ, but now AJ gets out.
Okay.
On the shuttle at his home.
Is that a handicap?
I make a motion to send it to committee.
I'll say that.
Motion by Jeff to send it to a committee, a new bond committee, yes, or a...
Just any committee.
Operation committee. Second question, Lisa.
No, he said any committee.
All in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carried.
Thank you for your time.
I just wanted to show the board to, you know, for a very frustrating matter, I really appreciate our correspondence all the way through this, and I look forward to working with you on it, and we'll hopefully come up with a solution that can work for everyone.
Well, I signed up for your safety committee, but it just isn't working very well with my work schedule. But I am trying to get more involved. I know that was a question that we had, and unfortunately, I've only been here 2 years, so I don't know as many people as I would like. And I guess my goal is that, you know, I've joined the Music Boosters Club because my son's very involved in music, and I'm trying to make strides so that this wouldn't have to be an issue. But unfortunately, I'm just not able to find someone to help out after schools. Otherwise, I wouldn't even approach. So I just appreciate the time and consideration. Thank you.
We'll be in touch, and I'll let you know.
Something.
Draft policy.
Before you are a series of draft policies in the 100 series. This picks up with the policies 142, 44, 50, 51, 50, and 526. The 100s through the, or the 142 through 151, or I'm sorry, yeah, through 151.2 are just the next iteration of WASB recommended policies that updates our current. And so I've given you the current policy as we have it now, and then the draft sample policy as recommended by WASB. All of that will then be brought forward for a second reading next month, if you've had a chance to review. But I certainly would take any questions, suggestions, recommendations. And then after the 151s, I bring to your attention policy 526.1, which is employment references and verification. And the reason that that's out of sequence is there's a state statute Mr. Bush brought up to my attention that requires us to have this policy in place. And so it would be better to just take care of this policy earlier rather than waiting for us to get past the 100 series and up to the 500 series. So you'll see that one a little bit out of sequence, but it's there before you as well. So I'll open it up for discussion, and we can look at anything you'd like to look at. We will bring all of these back for a second reading at another time.
I move that policies, the drafts you have for 142, 144, 526, go directly to next month's meeting as a second reading. But policies 150, 151, and 151.2. I would like to see those go to the policy committee for further discussion. I looked over the policy resource guide for WASB, and there are multiple samples for many of these policies, and I like some of the language in some of the other samples, and I don't think it's warrants a major discussion here at the full board level, but I think at a policy meeting.
Thank you.
So 142, 144.
526.
And 526.
Is the motion on the floor needing a second?
Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Any other discussion? And then the rest of that just moves to
to committee.
Move to committee.
All right.
So when you say move to next month?
For the second reading.
For second reading on 142, 144, and 526. And then the other three policies would go to committee for further discussion and come back next month for first read.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Strategic plan?
I have, and Susan Webb is here, so Susan, if you want to join us, just grab a chair and join us. The one I have loaded up here is the original. Susan, do you want me to dig for that? There's just a subtle change, I know.
There was some wording. One of the word millions was missing, so that was kind of a major one, but we caught it.
So I'm going to go with, there's a couple iterations to this, but not an overall change. So let's use this one for now, because it's loaded up, and I can bring the other one up if needed. So I just wanted to reframe that we had, as part of the district's strategic plan and goals for this year, was to create an infographic that would try to capture the district's story from a financial perspective. We worked with our in-house supports to try to bring a first rendition together. It needed some additional shaping, and this is right in Susan's wheelhouse as far as what she does well, and every day for that matter. And so we started working together over the past couple weeks and month, trading information back and forth. And what you have before you is the black and white version in your book, but a color version up on the screen of the infographic as we have it right now. We're looking for input and feedback. But before we do so, maybe Susan, just walk us through the infographic and kind of share some of the your thinking as you created it.
Okay. Well, there was a lot of numbers and a lot of stuff to show. So on one side, I thought, let's show the finances on one side and do the achievements on the other. So that's how I decided to structure it. It's pretty self-explanatory as you go through, hopefully. Starting the 2016 budget, where the money is coming from, the expenditures, where the money goes. And then we wanted to show the change in revenue over the years and the change in expenditures. So those are just your basic pie charts and line charts. There was some discussion when I was at the previous meeting about some of these words. We don't really know what inter-district payments mean, so we added some language at the bottom that talks, you know, kind of spells that out a little bit. Also, there's a little note at the bottom. There's a lot of different funds involved with school funding, but we just focused on funds 10 and 27 because of those are the ones we use for operations. So that's the top part. And then going to the bottom left there, just breaking it down, how much it costs to educate per pupil. It sounds like a lot of money, and it is. So we just kind of went through showing, just breaking it down dollar by dollar, and also how we compare to other districts and what the state average is. So gives you a little snapshot there. And then on the right, state revenue, you can kind of see over the years how it really dipped a lot. And that's what the revised one does have different language there. It focuses a little bit more on that dip in 2012 when our state funding got cut quite a bit, and how and then we passed a referendum to make up for that. And then in the enrollment, you can kind of see our trend over the years, and just talking a little bit about how enrollment matters because it affects our funding.
Is 2711 our really enrollment, or what is our actual
2016
enrollment?
In 2016.
Is 711.
I think this is when we talked about having an infographic. I think this is like exactly what I had in mind. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's the kind of thing, if you were going to referendum, this is the kind of thing you get in the middle. And it seems like the kind of thing that should be in front of the taxpayers all the time.
Yeah, one of the WASB conferences that I went to where I talked about community engagement, obviously it's been tweaked to a minor point, but the achievements on the back and the financial sort of impact to the community is almost exactly what they had up there.
Right.
This is something you should be updating yearly,
okay.
or is often, I mean, this should be the focus to really engaging your community, because you're showing them all of what the expenses actually go for, which is these achievements and the excellent work that the students are doing.
And
so
you
this
did
what
a
you're
nice
getting
job.
For your money, kind
that's
of.
Right,
yeah.
You did a nice job making it clear, but being completely loaded with information. I mean, there's a lot in it. But it's not, it's totally, it's understandable. So I really appreciate all the work you've done. And Joelle, too, you were starting well.
Yeah, this is not my wheelhouse, so I was
If you divide your 10.9 million by 7-Eleven, that becomes over 15,000, doesn't it?
Well, we can go back and do the math. I mean, I can't do the math right now. I mean, I did go through all the spreadsheets that were provided, so we can certainly pour over this and make sure all the numbers are right, for sure.
I think your fine is higher than that if you just take calculated and figure.
Could it be the difference between the actual numbers of students versus the FTE equivalent, Luke? Or?
Yeah, because you're right, the enrollment does take actual district residing residents enrollment is 7-Eleven, but the number of dollars that we get in state aid is offset by open enrollment, which isn't factored in that 7-Eleven. So we have students that are going in and students that are coming out. This 7-Eleven, for example, counts students that are in our district but are going to Dodgeville. And it doesn't count the kids that are coming in from Dodgeville into Mineral Point. So there's some numbers there that you're right, they won't tie directly. You know, I think that's a different infographic if we wanted to put it in. So I appreciate the suggestion because we're looking at enrollment separately with district butts and seats that are Mineral Point kids. And Mineral Point kids born and raised has dropped from 796 to 7-Eleven. But our current number of kids we have in school is more like 750 right now, I believe.
725. But you're thinking that you could add a chart, maybe an open enrollment chart.
Sure. That's a possibility if you felt like that had.
Or would it, I mean, yeah.
You could. I think it's the point we're trying to make. Are we trying to say that we're getting fewer dollars, or are we trying to say that fewer pointers are going to school here? Either way, to your point, people will do the math and say it doesn't add up. So maybe it's something we can add into the wording.
Yeah, I think it's a good point. I think I like the idea of having the open enrollment figures in because you look at the decline in enrollment is sort of a bummer. But there are reasons for it that are, you know, there's less people. So it's not like people are opting to leave. But the open enrollment numbers shows that we've got more people coming in and fewer going out.
Right.
I didn't think it was a lot, but it's some.
It's better than it had been.
About 20 difference.
Something like that.
There is a difference for sure.
Yeah.
Well, and I think the story that's painted between the 796 and the 7-Eleven is 85 students times $10,000 per student is $850,000. Of revenue that we no longer have because we just have a smaller enrollment. We're still running the same number of routes. We're still, you know, putting together a lot of the fixed transportation and food service costs that are embedded with our districts. So that's part of the challenges to why we're having struggles to every year come up with tightening our belts and putting together a budget when we have fewer students to work with. It means fewer dollars coupled with, and I think you do a nice job of sharing the picture of just state revenue and how that's flatlined. Our state revenue now is very similar to 2009 rates. We have the same amount of state revenue. So where is that excess coming from? Is just a transfer to our local taxpayers. So that's why they're picking up more and more of the costs of students because the state has actually reduced its overall fulfillment of or commitment to fulfill funding for students. So I think this does tell a lot of different stories, depending on, you know, there's actually stories behind the stories, if you kind of dig into the data and really, well, what does that mean to have students go, because we don't explicitly say 796 to 7-Eleven translates into a loss of $850,000 in funding for our schools over that 7-year period. So it's 12 or 8, 9-year period. But there's that other underlying story, so. We're going to keep this up and continue to take your feedback over the next month and really let you scour it and share it with friends or colleagues. We'll even maybe do a pilot release with our team leaders and some of our staff meetings and get some additional feedback. And if we're feeling like it's pretty tight, then I think we go forward with sharing the infographic and potentially publishing. I didn't see it published certainly in our newsletter. On our website, and maybe just as an attachment to a you know, a note to all parents, but then an annual update to just kind of bring the numbers up to speed. And if you feel like there's more story to tell here, let us know.
Yeah, I mean, I think a working session about this helps tell the story, because then each of us can go into the community and say exactly the question. When someone asks a question like Laddie just asked, there's 20 people that know and can continue to tell the story that school funding is complicated. It's not ever usually this number goes into this number. There's some sort of hidden, you know, magic in the formula. But as long as we are able to sort of speak to that, it will head off some of that just misconception about it, that we continue to spend more and have fewer kids, and we're constantly sort of, I think that the board constantly battles is some of that messaging we can head off.
What do we get for an open enrollment
kid? The number right now is $6,700.
And that's really going out. That's right. And so we make taxes more of it sometime. So that's only about half of this.
Thank you, Susan, for your work.
That's
good.
A suggestion, if there's some that the board might want to pull out and have further discussions on, it might be wise to do an approval of the items that you have no questions or concerns about and do a kind of a consent agenda around, like much like Ms. Hayden, you know, 1, 3, 5, 7, and then we'll pull those other ones out, talk about them, and vote on them one by one. If you want to just move from top to bottom, we can do that as well, but we'll start with motion and discussion. We don't need to get too far into the weeds on any of this. The backup material is there. Most of these items either need board approval or have a $5,000 threshold which require board approval. And Roger, thanks for being here to just answer any questions that you might have.
Let's just go one.
Okay.
Follow this. One by one. Sweep agreement. Standard.
Standard. That's the I think there's 12 schools. There's 22 schools in our group, but 12 schools, and the sweep agreement there is we jointly own equipment. So we are, I think we're up to like 10 or 11 pieces of equipment now. And it's equipment that we used to all go on our own and rent and pay. Now we originally came up with $2,500 to buy into it. Now it's like, I think it's $250 a year now. That
age 53.
We use that for maintenance of the equipment. It's one piece of equipment we got there. When we used to first had our group get together, that equipment used to cost us $300 a day to rent. That same piece of equipment right now is a little over $1,000. So it's gone not much in about 12 years.
So it's a good deal.
It's a good deal. The first year that we did, just in Middle Point, we saved between $8,000 and $10,000.
So I move that we approve the sweep agreement.
Second. Roll call.
Hay?
Yes.
Stevenson?
Yes.
Basting?
Yes.
Bush?
Yes.
Dolphin?
Yes.
Steffes?
Yes.
Approval of driveway path. So I'll have your recommendation.
Yes.
Okay. Explain this.
Okay, what it is after the last meeting, actually Larry Urban told me that Midwest Hill Code does that 4x6 infrared for the potholes. So he came back and gave us a quote for all the potholes. He came up with 52 of them for a total of $5,000.
This is out here.
And you should have in there the other quotes he has for seal coating and crack filling, the rest of it. Now, in the past 20 years since we've been out at the site, we've stayed at right around $10,000 total for both buildings for seal coating and patch filling. So it's, I guess it's, if we want to stay at that limit, but the fact like I said, that just the potholes is $5,000 on itself.
And then this other thing is
like the north side lot and road. That was the north side parking lot and the road coming from Ross Street all the way around, come out back on Wetland Lake Road. That would be that one. That one there now at the elementary, we do the elementary, and that's the lower playground area. It's $2,400 to do that. Now, at the high school, when they do it, all the yellow lines is part of the contract. At the elementary school, down there, we have games and stuff. We do that in-house.
And getting other bids?
We had, the first 2 years we did, and we haven't ever since. They've always came in with the lowest. So, I mean, if they want more bids, I'll probably get more bids, but...
But you said it used to be $10,000 for the whole shebang?
No, we would only spend $10,000. That was the limit. The board put me on a limit not to exceed $10,000. So if like here, 68, 45, and 5,000, the 11,000, that would be over the $10,000 in the past they let me spend.
What have you done in the last few years?
The last couple of years, we've been right around 11,000.
No, but which projects?
Okay, we did the far parking lot over by the, you know, where the new bleachers are.
Yep.
And then we did the elementary lower part.
So those aren't even included in
this. So where our main road coming into the high school here is breaking up on the corner out here, Roger. Dennis is going to come in and heat them up, roll back out. And did he say how many years we'll get out of that process?
I don't think you'll get anybody that'll guarantee you a blacktop.
To give you an idea.
I mean, he's saying if you do it, if it's 4 inches thick there and he puts it back 4 inches, we've got 20 years out of it now. But I think the problem you're going to get is, even though you're doing that bottle, you should still have hairline cracks coming over when all we're doing is blowing them out and crack filling. So hopefully, I mean, they tell us 25 years is what you're looking for. And, you know, overall, our parking lots look pretty good. It's just that main road that's gotten bottled really bad.
And if we were to go in there and re-grind that and resurface it, relay it, you're looking at $100,000.
Oh, you're looking a lot more than that.
Maybe more.
It was, when we did this building up here, it was like $265,000.
Is it probably $300,000?
Maybe, yeah.
Because I'm comparing my lot to it. And mine was like over $100,000. Another lot smaller than this square footage here. Yeah, money in the budget.
Which one did you pick then?
Well, it depends how you look at the budget. I've got, you know, a certain amount of money left right now to get through the end of the year, and I'm hoping that I've been fairly conservative. Andy made the comment one time, I'm too conservative how I spend my money, but I got to make sure it gets through. I'm hoping I'll have about $20,000, but there is some other things that I would like to get out of this year's budget yet, and one of the items is coming up here. But so it's, yeah, some of that I could rather come up with.
Well, that
I also, I think
it is, yeah, and it looks terrible too.
And I also think, Luke, you can correct me on that. I know every year we do have a little bit on energy for energy savings. It's been a mild winter. I don't know what kind of we're looking at there, but I'm hoping we have some there that I could have some access to, but I can never guarantee that.
Yeah, we have reduced the energy budgets because we've been recognizing the savings, so there's not the savings there. There is money in capital maintenance to do these projects if we choose to do them. Larry had asked if I approve of all of these. I certainly approve of repairing our buildings. I take a little bit of concern about putting money into the driveway areas where we know we need to replace eventually. We're throwing money into patching and cracking something that we just know will have to be replaced, and we're just prolonging the time that it will take before it's going to eventually have to be replaced. So I'd rather put that $5,000 into an account, let it carry over to a way to replace it. But you know, there's other areas where I think it is wise to continue to be preventative in its maintenance, to fill those cracks annually. We've been doing that, and I think we can prolong and have done a nice job of prolonging our parking lots to a good degree. But the upper elementary and the road on the north side are just and south side are just areas that I think are 20 years now. We've been putting a lot of money in, but just to kind of keep them filled with potholes with asphalt in them, and I'm not sure I would put more money into trying to maintain that much longer.
Your proposal doesn't have the upper parking lot at the elementary.
No. We talked about that over the last year. I mean, I talked to Iversons, they came out and looked at it. You know, it will maintain itself without doing anything, you know, 3 to 5 more years. Once it starts breaking up, then it becomes a danger. Right now, it's not breaking up. It's cracking. And you drive down there, glad you've been down for baseball games, and you've been down there. You've got that honeycomb effect. Once that starts coming up, then it becomes a danger.
It looks worse than it is.
But talk about, that would be a project that we'd have to do totally when we do it.
So to clarify, Roger, $5,000 for the infrared, right?
Right.
And then, and then on the next page, lot and road, there's a north side lot and road for $6,485. That's seal coating, right?
Crack filling and seal coating.
Front lot and road.
Front lot is the one across where we did last year, where we put the new parking lot going into the stand, the grandstand over there now. That would be that one and doing the main road. I didn't think we needed to do that again because we just did it last year. The road we didn't do, but we did do the parking lot after we put the new blacktop in and did seal coat.
So they were recommending doing something that was done last year?
He just gave me a figure. And I asked him to do the whole parking lots, all the areas, put them together. And because I told him, there's no way that we'd do it all, probably. I just wanted a breakdown.
So is that the same with the parking lot, or the playground at the elementary school? That was the most recent one done, and that's what they're giving us an estimate for.
That road means the whole road?
That 52, that 52 spots is the whole entrance road coming from Ross Street.
The whole road.
We should get by.
Yeah.
All the way.
So what you're recommending that we do is this first infrared $5,000 this year?
I am based this on the comments that you guys made at the last board meeting about the potholes. This would correct the potholes that are out there right now.
Okay.
Is this a long-term fix like Luke brought up?
No.
It's probably not a long-term fix. It's a 3 to 5 year fix probably.
And then moving down, out of them three, which one?
If you're going to do those three, I would do the 6845. That does the parking lot right in front of the school here. It does the driveway all the way from Ross Street all the way back to Mike Road or High Street, whatever you want to call it.
Okay, and then the other two we're not doing?
No, because we did the one at the elementary last year.
Okay.
Actually, the one on the right, excuse me, this is the elementary system. That's the basketball court, and it's the walking path. I can't recommend seal coating the walking path. That's breaking up. You know, it's the same as the other parking lot. It needs to be replaced.
Where
the basketball court.
The walking path that goes.
You know, it goes all the way around the school.
Oh.
And the basketball court is in good shape. We could break that down and get a price. I mean, because that's in good shape. But we don't drive on that. That's why it's holding up right now. So I mean, I guess if we could do it, is to break it down and do the basketball court north side and the main driveway, and to me it doesn't do a lot of good to crack fill and seal coat the road without filling the potholes.
Right.
I mean, and to show you how bad it is, I just filled most of those last week, and as you drove it tonight, it lasted a week. So it's, I guess it's, if you went that route, you're talking 11,000. If they do that, you're probably talking around 12,000, 12,500 to do just those few.
An approval would mean now if money is available or part of
we do
next fiscal year.
Spring to June, it'd be done before June 30th.
So it would be this year's budget?
Yeah. Correct.
My feeling is that I think we need to do those two items this year, and that'll give us three to 5 years possibly. And then I think that we definitely need to be looking at some type of a long range thing where we borrow a million or whatever and really fix some of these problems.
All right, do we have a motion to approve the $5,000, the $6,485, and the $2,575?
Well, if we just do the basketball court, it won't be quite that much, but
okay.
I would have to get that redid. And like you asked Lisa, I mean, I could bid it out somewhere else, but like I said, we did bid it out for 3 years, and
so
this company always came
in.
Yeah,
I was just wondering why they had a bid on there for something that was done last year.
He just did the whole thing.
Yeah, that's where I was confused.
I'll make a motion for the $5,000 and the $6,485. He wants to bring us back the basketball court. We're going to look at that.
Do it second.
I'll second.
Second by Larry.
Just a quick discussion item. It would be under the $5,000 threshold, so it wouldn't necessarily need to be brought back. If we felt like it was something to be done in conjunction with when they're here, we would just throw it in or not, depending on what Roger and I thought, if they were okay with it.
Okay.
It should be less than half that, though.
Yeah, about less than half that.
Most likely, we'll just do it.
Do a roll call, Angie.
Fasting?
Yes.
Bush?
Yes.
Dolphin?
Yes.
Hay?
Yes.
Stevenson?
Yes.
Stephens?
Yes. Tractor replacement.
I talked a little about this last year. We used to be on a deal, we traded every 2 years. As a $5,500, we got a lot of tractor outright, paid $5,500 every 2 years. Got a full warranty tractor, we had no maintenance costs. Our tractor now is like 8 years old, it's got over 3,000 hours on it. I spent a little over $2,500 on it last year. Just let you know, if this doesn't go through tomorrow, I'm gonna spend about $800 replacing tires on it. All the tires are bald. But not putting pressure on you, want to be aware that I am gonna spend at least that this week if we don't look into it. So, I mean, I would love to get back on that 2 year trade thing. I mean, it saves us, because once it gets out of warranty, it kills us. And we do put a lot of hours. We're mowing between 20 and 30 acres between the two sites. So we're mowing a lot of land. And we have looked into, you know, contracting it out. I know three times in the last 20 years. And the lowest bid I've got for contract is $30,000. So,
I would
$9,500 buys us a tractor, really gets us 2 years.
What's $9,500? A new tractor?
It's a new tractor and a new deck.
Trade over that.
Yeah, this one I would strongly encourage you to consider. The reason we got out of the 2 year cycle was we thought, well, let's roll the dice and maybe there's not a lot of maintenance on it and maybe we can get a longer life or shelf life out of a mower if we don't trade it in every 2 years. What we're finding is it's nickel and diming us more than it would be if we just trade it in under warranty and just keep flipping it out every 2 years. So the point being, if we go back to this model and anticipate a tractor coming back in 2 years, so that it doesn't fall out of warranty, and then we're covering parts for decks and tires and those kinds of things. So I think it's the better model of the two. We've tried both, and I would support Roger's recommendation here.
I'll make a motion to approve the trade.
Motion by Jeff. Do you have a second?
What do you suppose?
Second.
Over
2 years.
So is the motion to go back to a 2 year deal?
No, just to buy the tractor.
Yeah, right. 2 years.
And the trade is 900, correct?
The trade is 55 on this one.
Oh,
this is
no,
5,500.
So how much is
the trade? 5,500.
Right, so.
Every 2 years.
Okay. Every 2 years. I didn't know that was the same. So it's been 8 years.
What's the tractor run note that you're getting?
15,000. So this isn't the 2 year deal, but you're recommending the 2 year deal, but you're asking for a motion on the trade, which is not the 2 year deal.
What we're basically doing is buying a new tractor. And then, we would get on this rotation again in 2 years straight again.
Well, I'm not necessarily saying that in 2 years you'll need to come back and ask us again.
Correct.
Yeah, we understand that.
Yeah.
But my point being is that if we go back to buying new rather than maintaining old, I'll come back in 2 years and suggest that we do the trade in. So this would be the first step to moving toward that. It doesn't necessarily bind the board in any way.
And on this one here, I have checked around to other dealers, and two dealers said they can't believe that we can do it for this.
Of the more,
it's a 60-inch deck.
60-inch deck, how many horse?
30 horse.
And it's got a mower on it.
It's got a mower.
All right, so we have a motion and a second.
Yeah.
Any other discussion? Roll call.
Basti?
Yes.
Bush?
Yes.
Dolphin?
Yes.
Hay?
Yes.
Stevenson?
Yes.
Stephens?
Yes. Tile replacement.
Okay, after the last meeting, to do the four rooms is going to run us 30-some thousand. I gave you the figures last time we got together. I went back and just cut it in half. I think you should have the figures. It's
16,605.
And that would do three rooms, the two big classrooms plus a small office area. And then that would leave us two rooms plus another small office area to be completed. It actually works out better from our standpoint, my staff's standpoint, and our summer school. To do four rooms, we're going to actually block the lower hallway at the elementary for 2 to 3 weeks, which would go right to the summer school. By doing this, we don't have to block the whole hallway. We can leave a minor track.
they will be out of the building, so you don't have to worry about them being there when summer school. It's replacing the tile. We can't seal it for 2 weeks after it's put down. So we have some logistics that we have to work around. But.
So does this give you more money out of your budget than their $14,000
extra? Well, see, that's what I'm going to find out, because in the past, this is, if I have money left over, I do this. If not, in the past, we've had between $65 and $75. I think that's the number that we put in capital maintenance. Mm-hmm. It just depends if I have money left over or not. And that's what I need to find out, because if I'm going to do that when we want to in June, I have to have money out of this budget, because it has to be done out of this year's budget. If I want to wait until July, I will hold off to next June.
There is money in the capital budget to do this project.
Okay.
But the whole project will not be finished. There's still going to be some left over for next year.
Be one more phase, right?
And if you were to hold off this year, then you could put this money into the dust collector.
We'll have money to be able to do both if you wanted to this year.
Do you have a motion to approve?
Correct. Not the entire floor project, but to do the dust collector and two upper rooms. Or three, this is actually three rooms. We could cover that, yes.
But not the other three.
Not the other three. Okay. But just to me, that'd be more problematic.
In case you wanted these rooms are Mrs. McGuire's rooms, and then the computer server room.
Motion by Julie. Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Second by Larry. Any discussion? Roll call.
Stevenson?
Yes.
Basting?
Yes.
Bush?
Yes.
Dolphin?
Yes.
Kay?
Yes.
Steffes?
Yes. Dust collector system.
We, Roger and I, met together. We looked at four different companies. We did an apples to apples comparison, looking at pricing between the different companies. We talked about other factors besides just price, but we are recommending low bid of using the Donaldson system. The total is $57,729.70 that would be installed. It does include things that are under our district's contract, which would be a concrete pad, electrical permits, and fees. We are not recommending a fire suppression system at this time. It does have a spark arrestor system in it, which does, on the exterior part of the building, stop any fires from taking place. The fire suppression system is inside the building, actually has a sprinkler system that would douse the system, and we don't feel the need to have two fire suppression systems essentially working in tandem. We checked in with our EMC insurance company, Tricor. There is no premium reduction for having an additional fire suppression system in it. It's just an extra add-on if the board so chose, but Roger and I don't feel that the $8,000 to $9,000 is necessary in this particular case, because it does have a spark arrestor system in it.
Think you'd be interested in the silencer at all?
The silencer is included in this.
It is included.
It is, okay.
Yeah.
And when would this be installed?
This would be installed, again, it would be a project that we'd start. It's probably 6 to 8 weeks to order the equipment, and it'd be a June install for fiscal year.
Today, we're in Nippentuck, because they told me four to five weeks to get the permits, 4 to 6 weeks to get them. I assume once they apply for the permits, they will, at the time, order. I think they had on that contract, they wanted 25%, I think 25% down.
That's right.
For the equipment, but so we would be really close, you know, if we got it working out that we'd be done sometime towards every June.
I move that we approve the Donaldson.
Motion by Lisa, second by Jeff. Warranty with the Donaldson system, Roger.
Every company, the only company that would go more than 2 years guarantee. Was that Wesco one, and he says they need to go out 10 years, but there would be an additional charge. All the rest of them are 2 years, you know, it's pretty standard, except for that equipment.
Would sell you an additional charge?
I'm assuming Wesco would, the other companies will. I never really checked into it. because Wesco, that was one of their selling points, we'll give you an additional, you know, but it's included in the price.
Not included in there.
It's included in the price.
And Wesco, the tenure?
They said they'd include that in there.
And theirs is only $58, $400 more?
Well, there's, when you look through down through the bid, that's the bottom line they put, but the, some of the extras could add, like a crane, all those kind of things will add that up. They don't have that in there.
And Donaldson does have it in there?
Yeah.
So you're recommending the Donaldson?
Yeah, after all, it's, what we figured, about $6,000, $7,000 difference, like when you start adding the things into it.
Any other discussion?
I'd like to see us consider including this in the roof and maybe another small project. Now that we've done the due diligence and gotten the price down, and bring Nexus back in, just I feel like without a project manager for the roof or the install, we're putting it on Roger, and I'm not necessarily sure that's his duty to be an install project manager. I think we've done the due diligence to reduce the cost where it would be a minimal to no effect on the mill rate. If the state comes through with their $200 a student, and we could look at the dishwasher perhaps, and then we get something for our walk-away fee.
I mean, it has come down considerably since Nexus was recommending $310,000 for the dust collector.
Right, and the roof has as well. So we get our 18% from the state.
If we were to do this as a performance contract, don't we have to approve that in the fall? And so couldn't this not be done until later in the fall?
That is correct in that you actually, when you certify the levy, that's the time that you would have a levy exemption for a performance contract for energy efficiency. Nexus said they would be willing to carry the project forward. In other words, pay for the project out of pocket with the assurance that you're going to go in the fall and put it under a performance contract at that time. So they would just front the money to get the project to go in the summer, and then you would be able to still get the project done, but not actually certify the amount due until later.
And then would there be a 20% fee to Nexus?
There would be a fee. It would depend on the project. I think they've shared that it's ranged in that 15 to 18% range from what I recall. And I don't know if that would be the case because we've already done the solicitation of vendors to receive the request for proposals, so that part comes off. They're not doing that piece anymore. They would just be managing the project on the back end to make sure that everything meets code and specs and is installed correctly. I don't know if that would be a reduced fee because there's no management up front of this project. It would be just on the back end.
But doesn't this company have to make sure it's done according to specs?
Well, they
can't install after we quarterly.
But we need to ensure that that happens.
Who's going to ensure it? Or
yeah, who knows?
Like when Riverdale did theirs, they had like one of those, like one of the companies.
Who's they using? McKinn Street.
McKinn Street. They had a third party.
What did they get for their idea?
I thought when you guys went down there, they did like 67,000.
No, I mean, for saying that's just 20%. That's their trouble. To me, 20% is a lot of money to watch that project.
But you got to remember, it's not just the fees that's met or what they clear. That includes all of their design, architect, and management fees. So that's not their profit. That's stuff that, you know, we've done a little bit of that in-house. Roger and I have spent a lot of hours poring over this. I would say between talking with the four vendors, we've got 20-plus hours, maybe 40 or so of Roger's time that's not being factored into what they would have done on our behalf. Then again, on the back end of managing this project would be time that you've got to expense to the project that Roger would be overseeing it. So
that's another one of my concerns is if he's installing this in project managing a roof repair, who's our maintenance manager if you become our engineer?
Do you feel that this is an issue?
When you guys had me look into it, I looked at companies that all had engineers on staff. So I mean, all these companies, like Larry's bringing up, but I'm looking at it from that standpoint. They're going to build it the way they engineer it. I'll send it to the state. Back, Annie's trying to bring up. I'm not, I don't admit or I'm not qualified, I'm not an engineer, I admit I'm not an engineer, that's why I work with these companies. So, I mean, I'm fairly, I mean, comfortable these guys are going to build it the way they do, but except there's other things that they're bringing up here now that are out of my...
I suspect if we have three different people look over Roger's shoulder, Roger's still going to be there as many minutes as if Roger was doing it on his own.
If the motion's coming, if we're going to take you, you can have three inspectors, we'll still take you. We know how to do it, and we'll have to down legally.
I just want to comment on that 20%. That keeps getting thrown out. And like Luke said, it's not a full 20% profit. Whatever research or anybody that they have to hire, they take that out of there. So let's say they had to pay someone $1,500 to do something. That comes out of their 20%. And that's not being made clear by anyone here.
But it's still 20% of the district.
Yes, I
so
understand
that. So it's still
20%
cost but, to us, Kelly.
Yes, but it's not being presented. It's being presented that they're making the 20%.
I don't care if they're making 20 or 50.
I think they said that.
They told us they make 20%.
They also, if you would have asked, they didn't explain that all those fees come out of there. And I'm not defending them. What I'm trying to say that this is a contractor's issue. This is how all contractors, and
I
if
totally
they're
get
lesson,
it.
You get it?
But it's still 20%. The bottom line is it costs the district 20%.
Well, we get 18% back from the state.
Yes.
And a $10,000 walkaway fee.
And if we do it ourselves.
No, you pay the $10,000 walkaway fee either way.
Right.
That's true.
That's the way it was done to start with.
Yep. Okay, I thought that was still on the table because we had not paid them yet.
It was $10,000 upfront.
And this,
and I wasn't here to vote on it that day.
This
but that's the way it was.
Collector project is a straightforward project.
Yeah.
I can't imagine seeing too many problems during construction. Myself.
I can't hear.
The other
was will our pad included in this? About our
pad is in our expenses, but it's included in the price.
And you said we have money, Luke, in the budget to cover this?
Correct. We can use some of our capital dollars to cover the dust collector system. The one thing that we will not be able to do, and this is, again, a reason why I would advocate looking at a performance contract, is would be a revenue exemption that would have energy efficiency measured to it. So then if you use those dollars underneath the operational budget, you can't reuse them to buy a tractor or buy computers for kids or instructional materials for next year. It would have to be used for the dust collector, but we can do both if we revenue exemption above the cap and levy this through a performance contract. I mean, buy the performance contract, dust collector system, and still have those dollars freed up for other instructional purposes.
But we could also borrow money and get 35% back and do it on our own, and instead of spending $500,000, we may spend $2 million.
You could take out a note to pay for this project, but it would be underneath the revenue cap. So you'd be paying those payments back.
But you get the 35%, roughly a third, back in state revenue. So you're
right.
Still going to gain.
Yes.
And you're not going to spend $8.5 million.
But those payments will be underneath the cap versus above the cap.
I understand that, but you're still
getting aided expenditure.
To be clear, I'm not advocating $8.5 million.
Well, that's what Nexus wanted.
I said now that we've done our due diligence, gotten this to 57, gotten the roof to a small project.
Exactly.
Now I'd like to see us consider taking the state money. But I thought the walk away was in place though.
Do we have a motion for the dust collector?
Yes, and a second.
We do. Okay. Any other discussion? More time. Roll call, Andy.
Hey.
Yes.
Stevenson.
Yes.
Bassing.
Yes.
Bush.
No.
Dolphin.
Yes.
Steffens.
Yes. Anything else, Roger?
That's my list.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Approval of CESA contract.
Annually, the CESA contract is for board approval. I laid out their fee structure for you so that you can see all of the different areas that we can subscribe for different services from CESA. What you'll note on the right-hand side, the contracted services, and again, this picks up on page 86 of your board packet. The contracted services for 2017-18, the total is
$24,273. When I first arrived in 2011, that number was closer to $75,000 or $80,000 worth of services. We have cut back significantly. In the last 2 or 3 years, we've maintained around $50,000. What you'll notice this year is the reduction of $25,000 is actually a shift in the money that we were putting into a contract for seats for the alternative school. We used to purchase 3 seats from CESA 3, and that would cost us $24,500 annually. Now we're using those $25,000 toward our own alternative school to offset some of those costs and expenditures. So we've reduced our CESA contract, but I just wanted to full disclosure that $25,000 is still being allocated for our alternative school. Just we're able to leverage that, and I'll bring this report as part of our agenda next week. But instead of just being able to get 3 seats, we've had almost up to 6 kids from Mineral Point going through for that same cost. So we're able to use those dollars more effectively and impact more kids. So you'll see a shift in this contract fees from one area to another.
Can you walk us through what some of these things are?
Sure. The agency administration is just that. It's the overhead to be a member. It pays for their buildings, their utilities, their connections, their administrative staff and clerical staff. It's divided across all of the different CESA districts and CESA 3, and everyone splits those fixed costs just to become a member of the consortium, and that part for us is $11,799, up from $11,292.
And are there any schools that opt out of their CESA?
I am not aware of any schools that are not part of the CESA 3 consortium, but it's certainly...
Or statewide that aren't part of whatever CESA group they're in.
I would imagine there are. I'm not aware of any. I know some schools in CESA 2, the greater Dane County area, just don't use services. They have enough in-house resources that they can do almost everything CESA does because they have a large department at their district level. There's some of these things that we simply don't have the staffing to be able to carry out because we're small and we're rural. So part of the CESA stands for Cooperating Educational Services Agreement. Thank you. I lost my acronym for a second. So the idea is that as a consortium of schools, we're able to leverage one person's components. And so I could walk you through some of the things we used to have that we no longer. You can kind of see that in the 16-17 budget. Most of those things have been suggested, but we just simply don't use them. Do you want me to get into further detail?
Yeah, I'm just curious what it is we're using.
So the first thing we're using is what's called the School Improvement Division membership. And I'll just kind of reference it because each one of these has the attachment of what that is. So for $5,000, you get the entire package. You can't a la carte it. But we get the call survey, which is a proprietary survey that you can use to assess your leadership. It entails what we call principal meetings. Those are monthly. PAC meetings, which are superintendent's meetings, which are monthly. In those meetings, they'll bring in Tony Evers, Mike Thompson, John Forrester, and others, as well as area, one of these that just came in was iReady, which is a company that is a replacement for the STAR benchmark assessments. It allows us to see these resources without them having to go to 30 different school districts and kind of showcase what they can or can't do. It also allows us to do volume purchasing for the BrightBite survey that we've used. That used to be, we were one of the first districts that used it, and it was so successful and resonated so well that CESA 3 leveraged better pricing by using all of the schools in the consortium buying into the package. So we're actually getting a better price than what we could have done alone. The SID meetings, the School Improvement Division meetings, the DAC meetings, our District Assessment Coordinator meetings, and then we've got 4 days on site where the group will come in. For instance, one is Lisa Arneson, who came in and worked with our administrative team on the Ford exam when it was released, looking at the data, helping us sift and sort it, and making sense out of it so that we could get into using that data to drive decision making.
And do we do, I mean, they come 4 times every year, and we maxing out on the...
We are not maxing out every year, but we are using those times, yes. We've certainly made a touch. This year, we've used those site dates. We were going to bring in staff to do things on technology and Google Apps for Education. One of their members is a Google-certified trainer, and Kristen Galli has worked with our leadership team on using the Google platform to expand our opportunities to network with others as well as our teachers. So those are kinds of the things that we'll bring them in for as needed. A lot of the other areas we don't use. The next one we would go down to is the license renewal of $2,500. This is where teachers will actually go to CESA, and PI 34 is the PDP process that teachers have to be go through in order to renew their license, and they have to have a certified reviewer. We have no certified reviewers on site currently at Mineral Point, so we need somebody that is able to review those PDPs, and that's CESA 3. It also is support for our new teachers. They go through a series of topical sessions that specifically helps them and guides them through the different components of us first year as a teacher. More of a cohort group that comes together and talks about the questions and challenges that they're having in the classroom. We use the academic and career planning, which is the education for employment. It's a service that helps us connect students with employment opportunities. Annie Paulsko works closely with people in the greater area to make those connections. And then we really move out. That's all of the possible scenarios. All these numbers here, we're not using any of those services currently. That's all we use in the administrative side of things. On the special education side, we've all but eliminated any of those needs. A lot of this, we used to contract for orientation mobility. We brought that in-house. We no longer have that fee. Again, it's a cost savings, and we're putting it into actually generating better services for our kids at no cost other than the salary benefits we pay. The SEEDS is the software program that we currently use to house our special education, individual education plans, IEPs. That drives a lot of our communications between and through software that kind of walks you through the paperwork of an IEP.
The elementary literature, you're not using?
The elementary, pardon?
The literature there, you're not using that?
No. We have most of our elementary literacy curriculum. They can come in and do an audit, but we feel like we have enough in-house expertise to do literacy well.
So we don't pay them a $4,300?
No, we do not.
No, the $11,000, is that on top of the $24,000?
The $11,000 is on top of the $10,500 and the $19,74.
He's asking. Grand total is 24.
That is correct. Grand total is 24,273.
Grand total for everything.
If we took everything.
If no, we took everything.
If we took the line items that we are interested in.
Is recommended.
These are what they offer, and this is what looks right.
That's what we're talking about, but it's 11,000 plus. So that's in that.
Yep. Yeah, 11,000 is in the
24. Yeah, we are using four services.
I'll make a motion to approve.
We have a motion by Jim. Second by Larry. Any other discussion? The agency administration, that's just...
It's an entry-level fee that you have to pay.
Overall cost divided out.
Yep. Before you came to subscribe for services, it's a...
All right. Is it based on size of school?
It is not. Well, I shouldn't say that. I guess I don't know their fee structure. I've never seen anybody else's CESA contract, so it might be per pupil based, but my assumption is it's just a flat fee divided, but I can look into that and find out.
Would be interesting to know that.
You know, we have the same administration as Platinum, for example. You know, I don't know. I will ask that question and respond back to the board.
Just be curious.
Okay. Any other discussion? All in favor? Roll call.
Bassing?
Yes.
Bush?
Yes.
Dolphin?
Yes.
Hay?
Yes.
Stevenson?
Yes.
Steffes?
No. A couple draft policies, one filling board vacancies.
These are the two policies that were before the board last week. If you look, the first is located on page 92 of your board packet, filling board vacancies. If you have any suggestions, I will take them. And otherwise, we look for a motion to approve.
I'll move to approve.
Motion by Lisa, do you have a second?
I'll have
it. Any big changes, Luke, between what we had and what we're getting?
I think the biggest change is it just clarifies the current policy seems kind of complex because it has two or three set points that kicks in. If it's if this, then that, if not this, then that. Mm-hmm. This is just a flat 60 days, and it's either A or B. So I just think it makes it simpler to follow.
Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? And the motion carried. Officers overboard.
Sample policy, sample rule go hand in hand. It just delineates the officers on the board, the president, vice president, clerk, and treasurer. Again, gives duties of each. We can always subtly tweak these duties, but it lays out the general responsibilities of each position. And rule as well.
I'll move to approve.
Motion by Lisa to approve.
I'll second.
Second by Andy.
But mostly if I'm carried out by the elected people to the board.
Correct. Yep.
What was the question?
If I have to do all that, I'm going to get out of here.
Well, you've appointed.
Huh?
Duties.
Yep, you can delegate.
That's
to the,
yeah.
Got it.
Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried. Superintendent's report.
The first is just a budget update as you follow the Joint Finance Committee and some of their work around the state. They have gone to a zero-based budget for transportation, which is essentially throwing the governor's proposal out and starting fresh at $0 and building it back up. That has some potential implications for the education budget, as those are the two largest items in the state budget. And if they decide to go further and fund roads more, that means that something has to come from education. There is also some concern that they might do the same with the governor's proposal to fund schools at the $200 and $204 per pupil categorical aid and start over at zero as well. And that's a very real possibility coming out of the joint finance meetings across the state. So we're staying tuned to see if the governor's proposal holds. I received in the mail a letter from Governor Walker asking school leaders to support his current proposal to put $650 million into education. I think there is some infighting that is happening, and he's not certain that without school leader supports that the Republican legislature will continue to support his education budget. So what this indicates is there's still a lot of uncertainty, and I don't anticipate clarity until the middle of July. Is when the governor usually has his proposal due, but the timeline can shift depending on some of the internal debates that are happening. So we'll continue to monitor that. And right now we're proceeding on a $0 increase, a $100 increase per pupil, which is the middle ground between the governor's proposal and $200 increases. Those three scenarios will drive a potential budget. I plan to bring a preliminary budget to the board in May. Inside of that we'll have a staffing report. We'll have a technology budget report. Some of our other larger known increases will be given out to the board at that time. We can start the process of having some budget discussions and deliberations. Certainly there could be possibilities for alternative meetings outside of the regular board meetings. We only meet monthly to go dig deeper down into some of the specifics of the staffing report, for example, or the technology budget if we want to go further. But that is related then to the second item, which is insurance premiums. They have put out on our behalf a request for information for our health insurance, and that has come back very favorably. Without the actual proposal being back from Dean Health, there is an anticipation of a 0% increase in our health insurance, which is a huge windfall for us because we were anticipating and budgeting for a 6% increase. So zero is certainly helpful. It doesn't necessarily eliminate the entire budget shortfall that we're potentially looking at, but it will put us in a position of strength. There are other districts that are looking at double digit. I've heard even as much as 20% increases in health insurance. Then behind that, our liability insurance and our workers' compensation insurance and our property insurance is projected to come in between 0% and 1%. That also is, again, very favorable, and it is not normal. So what do I attribute these not normal pieces to? I think we have a staff that is incredibly healthy and is using our health insurance system in the best way possible, which is attempting to set up meetings and physician care with your general primary care physician rather than going to urgent care. We have a staff that, for the most part, doesn't have a lot of falls and workers' compensation claims. We've been very few property damage claims, very few just liability insurance. We haven't had many, if any, legal issues that have come up that haven't been litigated where we need property insurance to cover some of our losses there. So, or liability insurance to cover losses. We've been very fortunate, and I think part of the message I'll be sharing with staff is that if we continue to do our due diligence to stay healthy and use our insurance system the way it was designed and continue to be safe and secure and keep our liability insurance at a minimum, those are dollars that free up that can only help in other areas of instructional needs and salaries and so forth. So I will bring back a proposal that will be in alignment with CPI, the Consumer Price Index, for salary increases, and try to build in the anticipated steps and other benefits that staff might have available to them. Any questions on the budget or insurance? Or can I clarify anything?
You said that you were asked about getting involved with the budget. Should we maybe have staff and put it out to the community that they need to email and send a letter to the representatives? Walker's budget wasn't going to be fantastic, but sounds like the
it is favorable, and it's more than what Tony Evers asked for initially. So it's certainly a favorable budget for K-12 education. It puts a priority in that funding. And certainly there could be some advocacy, certainly by our board, if not our community at large, to our representatives and others that you support, supporting K-12.
I went to the meeting on Monday, the Joint Finance Committee in Platteville. That would have been a great education. It was really, really important and enough.
How did you feel it went?
How do I feel it went? I think we have 9 Republicans up there and 5 Democrats. And it's really partisan controlled. So the people who spoke were for different areas because everyone, you know, it's a big budget. There were superintendents there, there were teachers there, there were college students there. If you speak to that joint finance committee, you can't go with the story and be emotional about it. You have to have your facts. You have to say, this is what it costs to educate a student in our school. This is what we're receiving from the state. This is what we need. And that $200 that he's proposing is not very much. A lot of the schools were asking for $300 or $400 per head. It really gets into how the codes are. Go ahead, Jeff.
So did you feel like the superintendents, I mean, because that's what I said, Walker's budget wasn't real great, but $200 is better than zero.
Yes.
And do you feel like they made their point, and did they actually listen to you? Yeah. I mean, I know I'm asking you to
kind of. They really listened to the college students. They had the best arguments. I really do feel that they did listen to the, because there were college, I mean, they were from all levels there. There wasn't just, you know, high schools or districts.
There's something about hearing it from the college kids, and or was there anybody from like the secondary high school level?
No.
My college is great.
Yes, but
I think it's good to have, because you need to have
it. But it was for allocated funds. So allocated funds comes out of the state budget, and it goes to the colleges for their all their organizations. So they were going to deplete all their organizations. So there were students there from like Milwaukee that said the farm, you know, they have a farm program, an organization that really works, and that speaker was excellent. There were 2 girls, 2 students from Madison, that one was for the Catholics on campus, and the other one was for the humanists, which essentially would be, you know, neutral. And they both got up and spoke together and told
how their, each of their groups communicate to each other and accept each other's ideas. That was so powerful because there was no division at all. A lot of people behind me thought that there was a lot of ADD behavior by the legislators. And I'm not sure what got them to, you know, what they were listening to and what they weren't. The people who spoke on an emotional level, you're not going to convince anyone on that. You have to have numbers. You have to know their formula.
So do you think that we should have staff and community get that out there on our webpage?
Well, you have to put it to them in a formula that what we get and why we need this. They're only numbers people. They're only going to understand numbers. That's it. But you have to say, this is your money. I kind of have an idea that what he's proposing, I don't know if it's going to come out of the omnibus, because nothing usually goes in what's proposed, that 95-page. Then it gets in the omnibus, and then it gets all juggled. It may not ever come out what you think it's going to come out, and you can't argue that. You can never address that second piece of legislation. That's it, you get it. You get what they give you. It's really deeper than what he's proposing if you don't understand the formula and how they arrive at that. But most of the formula, from what I have read, and I have a couple of experts that I reached out to, someone, a professor who studied this for 20 years, tax code law for school funding. He used to be at Marquette, he's in Boston now, and I reached out to him. And he had a 10-year-old paper, and he said it's still relevant today. Then there's another professor at Madison who writes for the layperson to understand all the tax codes. And I haven't gotten to all his stuff. But really what it does, all the tax breaks and all that really do not help rural schools. It helps rich districts and rich schools. So if that's never addressed, we're still stuck with what we got. And if we get 200, I mean, I think we'll probably be lucky, but I don't think that's enough.
Do we get student diversity?
We still qualify for sparsity aid. So I will continue to keep you updated on the budget, and we'll have some more information available at the May meeting to give us the best indicator of where we're at this time, given what we know. The third and final is the election results, and I just want to thank all four candidates for running. In Mr. Hawkins' words, you are all to be commended for running for school board. It's a noble position, and I am appreciative of everybody that ran, Mr. Thousand and Mr. Kinch, especially for their interest in the position. We did have a gift for Mr. Kinch upon his departure. This would have been his last meeting. We'll make sure that he gets that. But we want to thank him for his years of service, not just in the last 3 years, but over the tenure of his school board. And he has been a good voice for the community. And I'd like to welcome Ms. Gunlock and incumbent Mr. Basting, welcome you back to the board. And we look forward to working together and putting 3 more years of good leadership toward Mineral Point and its community. So thank you. That ends my report.
Any questions for Luke on that? You were mentioning the CPI index or cost. What is that?
My recollection is it's 1.68%.
1.68%, okay. Have you done the math on step increases and what that could be overall to our budget yet?
Not overall. Okay. I did do consumer price, but not overall with step and lien.
Any other questions? All right, that concludes the regular portion of our agenda. We will move into closed session. Two items.
Second.
Motion by Judy, second by Larry.